There we go. Good morning, everyone. My name is Eli Coleman, and I'm the director and professor of the program of human sexuality at the University of Minnesota Medical School. And I'm pleased to moderate and introduce our John Money Memorial Lecture, Esther Kismati. John Money, as many of you know, was a very distinguished sexologist of our time. He was born in 1921 in New Zealand and died in 2006. Upon his death, his estate bequeathed the Program of Human Sexuality funds to sponsor this memorial lecture. John was always the first inaugural lecturer at the WASC Congresses, and he was our dean of sexology. So, and he was an outspoken advocate for sexual rights, and so I think it's very fitting that we have Esther Kismati here with us today to give this memorial lecture. Esther is an international human rights lawyer, an expert, consultant to the World Association for Sexology, for Sexual Health. She was the main, architect of our revised Declaration of Sexual Rights, which she'll be talking about. She's worked with WHO, UNAIDS, UNDP, Asia Pacific, the Visiting Fellow at Yale Law School, and Visiting Lecturer at University College of London, University of Oslo. She's just an amazing, remarkable woman, coming from a very humble roots in Hungary, and now becoming an international star. And has brought sexual rights to the highest levels of our UN system. And so we are very fortunate to have worked with her for the past couple years on our revised Declaration of Sexual Rights. And very honored that you are here to present this memorial lecture. Please welcome Esther Kismati.
So much. I think I have never gotten such a beautiful introduction in my life. Thank you so much. I feel incredibly honored and pleased to be here today and present the John Money lecture. I would like to dedicate it to the renewed WASC Declaration on Sexual Rights. And I would like to express my deepest congratulations to WASC. To the experts, to the president, the external colleagues who worked on it very hard in the past 2 years. Why is it so important? The previous declaration had an incredible impact on the world. It was accepted in 1997 on the 13th Congress in Valencia, and then it was adopted by the Assembly in 1999 in Hong Kong. It built very strong partnership with international organizations as WHO, IPPF, UNFPA, and UNICEF. It influenced regional work, for example, with the Pan-American Organization of WHO, but also influenced national legal developments, for example, in Finland, the Sexual Rights Declaration inspired the development of laws and policies and also ethical guidelines. So there is a great expectation that the renewed declarations that takes into consideration the development that happened over the past decade on the field of human rights, sexuality, sexology, and sexual health will have even greater impact than the previous declaration that takes sexuality and human rights with incredible rigor. There is a timing. Oh, sorry, I should do that. So So there is an incredible political momentum for the adoption of the Sexual Rights Declaration. And Esther Corona will talk more in more detail about that on Monday on the Sexual Rights Session. There is the negotiation of the Sustainable Development Goals, that is the follow-up of the Millennium Development Goals. It's very important, we like them or not, because they will influence development agendas, influence the flow of money, influence the flow of programming, service delivery, and health system setups. There are several goals proposed that has a very close link to sexuality and sexual health, including on sexuality education, gender equality, and well-being. It's important from the sexuality and sexual health point of view that it's not only about health, it's about well-being. So it's not only the absence of disease, but the well-being perspectives are provided for people's health and personal integrity as an important component of being human. There is the revisit of the international, the program of action of the International Conference of Population and Development. That was the first document, that international global document that took sexual health and sexual rights very comprehensively, although it's subsumed under reproductive health and reproductive rights, that 20 years ago was a compromise. We are in a different world today, as the negotiation processes show to us. There is also a 20 years revisit of the Beijing Program of Action on Women's Rights that was also a very strong international document recognizing sexual rights. There is also a political momentum from the more technical point of view that may influence bus life more significantly and more precisely. There are several international strategies, global strategies, have been adopted and being adopted by WHO, other UN agencies and international organizations that are setting agendas at the national level as well. For example, WHO adopted the Prevention on Violence strategy last year that requires countries to report to the World Health Assembly every year about the implementation. This strategy is important because it talks about violence, sexual violence, and calls for health system interventions in a very comprehensive way. So it puts legal obligation on states to respect and protect human rights and health of people in relation to violence. There is a new strategy being negotiated at the moment and will be presented to the World Health Assembly on HIV and STIs. We are hoping that the strategy will be set in a very comprehensive human rights framework that, again, an opportunity to bring sexuality, sexual health, and sexual rights in the context of state obligations of actions. And that is probably very few of you know about, there is the revision of the WHO International Classification of Diseases. It's the 11th version, and from the sexuality, sexual health point of view, it will be more, probably the most revolutionary expected changes. The revision of sexuality-related issues that are currently classified under mental health are being revisited. And on the beta version that eventually has to be approved by the World Health Assembly by states, gender identity disorder is being recommended to be removed from mental health disorders as a recognition of gender expression and gender identity and move to probably to a different place that is not disease-oriented, but recognizing people agency in relation to gender identity and expression. It's not yet there. There is a lot of work to do, to work with governments and experts to make sure that this revision will go through. There is a revision of sexual dysfunctions that finally brings the body and the soul and the mind together. Again, on the beta version, it's not perfect. The eye is on you whether it will be perfect by 2018. And there is a revision of sexual preference disorders of sexual preference that is recommended to be renewed as paraphilic disorders. Consensual sexual activities that, such as sadomasochism or solitary activities such as fetishism is being recommended to be removed as variation of sexual interest and sexual behavior. And only those paraphilias are recommended to be kept when the arousal is connected to non-consenting adults or children or is causing significant distress of the person. Not perfect, but there are articles published about that. I will give more explanation on Monday about these changes. But it's really you who are in the room who can make it perfect, more deficient, the definitions and the diagnostic categories more perfect. You have the knowledge how to do that, both from the sexuality and the human rights perspectives. So those we who care about sexual rights, we live in a different world. We live in a world with development and innovation. We live in a world when AIDS transformed from a deadly disease to a chronic condition due to availability of drugs. When sexual pleasure became the attention of well-being, not only just to be free from violence or coercion, but to well-being, the center of attention of well-being, whether it comes to freedoms or it comes to health interventions. There are laws passing on a daily basis that recognize gay marriage and equal rights of people who have same-sex sexual interest, and legal gender identity recognition of those who wish to express their gender in various ways. For example, 2 days ago, the Polish parliament passed the legal gender identity recognition law. A week ago, the Irish parliament did it. And there is a flow of revolutionary parliamentarian changes all over the world. We live in the world of mobile phones, including in rural areas, including young people accessing mobile phones that enhances relationship, the establishment of relationship, but also provides protections, for example, from sexual violence. However, we also live in the world of sexual terror. Gay, lesbian, transgender people, sex workers, are subjected to murder, violence, discrimination in various ways on a daily basis in all parts of the world. There are children, 8 years old children in war and conflict zones who are selling sex for food for soldiers without being punished. And there are health system interventions when intersex children and babies are still subjected to normalizing surgeries without their consent. Or people are forced to be sterilized because of their disability, because of their gender expression, or because they belong to minority groups in a country. There is a sound and fury engaging with the politics and the law of sexual rights. We who care about sexual rights and affirm that sexual rights are founded in dignity, self-determination, we are in a new challenging place. We know that moral, culture, and religion is being brought for opposing sexual rights. But we are experiencing new developments as well. Earlier, religious and moral codes were put against Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Today, the opposition is using the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and Covenants to create their own claim. For example, grant the right to life to the fetus and opposing abortion, or opposing same-sex marriage or same-sex relationships. Why the World Declaration of Sexual Rights for Citizens? It makes a difference because it's grounded already recognized human rights. The right to life, the right to be free from torture and inhuman and degrading treatment, the right to non-discrimination, the right to privacy, and the right to be free from violence. These are not made-up rights. These rights are in international and regional conventions and national constitutions. Nobody is opposing the term, the right to voting rights. Nobody is opposing the term, right to fair trial rights. These are not rights that are in convention, but there is a common sense that we have rights about that. However, there is still no international recognition of sexual rights. These are rights as well that are being recognized internationally through alternative processes. Hence, the vast sexual declaration on sexual rights calling the attention to that with incredible legal rigor. These principles that are expressed in the preambula, also deriving from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and treaties, including dignity, autonomy, self-determination, the respect and protection of human rights that puts obligation on states. And the rights framework expresses freedoms and entitlements. The freedom to sexual expression, bodily integrity, to be free from violence, and entitlements to quality health services, but also being protected from violence. For example, the different rights, the right to equality and non-discrimination, for example, are spelled out in a rigorous way that give content and meaning to the rights. It, for example, expresses the prohibited grounds of discrimination and recognizes development. 20 years ago, the sexual orientation and gender identity was not recognized by international treaties as a ground for discrimination. Today it is. It's an incredible opportunity for action. It also recognizes and calls for formal discrimination, like discrimination in relation to sexuality in laws, but also substantive discrimination, for example, granting sexual rights for people who live with disability. These rights are being applied by authoritative bodies, not only at the international level, but at the national level as well. Decriminalization of same-sex sexual activity, decriminalization of sex work, is happening all over the world. Still, 76 countries are still criminalizing same-sex sexual orientation. It was the first case, the Tudan versus Australia, that brought the attention and the international human rights standards for decriminalization of same-sex sexuality. Since then, South Africa, Fiji, and many other countries decriminalized. There is an attention on VAS, how to bring these kind of principles together with partners to the 76 countries to remain to criminalize. If you look at the right to the highest attainable standard of health, the VAS Declaration brings content and meaning in the context of sexuality and sexual health. It recognizes pleasure as an attention of well-being, not only negative rights to protect from disease and infirmity. It also calls the attention of the underlying determinants of sexual health. When people don't have access to education and employment and housing, they cannot properly protect their sexual interest and sexual health. This is recognized in international documents, and now it's translated in the World Declaration to Sexuality and Sexual Health. One of the examples of education is comprehensive sexuality education. We know from the policy work that it's incredibly important. We work to bring scientific rigor to the content and meaning. What rights bring? Rights bring the contesting the debate, the solution of the debate between parental rights to raise their children according to their belief, and children's rights to access information and education. Several international, regional, and national courts are now protecting children's rights to information and education over parental rights to raise their children on their own beliefs, but they can do at home. But it's the responsibility of the state to provide enabling environment for adolescent children and adults to protect their sexuality, sexual health, and well-being. This one. The right to participation. There are certain rights that were very poorly understood or recognized in the context of sexual and sexuality and sexual rights. And they say, these are political rights. Why do we care? One of them is the right to participation or access to justice, remedies, and redress. Now, today, we have human rights standards and scientific evidence that actually participation makes a difference. It makes a difference from the autonomy and protection of bodily integrity and health perspective, but also it makes a difference in terms of health impact. One of the examples is, and it's well documented, and Zara Sardus will give an excellent presentation about the 20 years of reform of decriminalization of sex work in South Wales, Australia, that what difference it makes in sex workers' rights to be participating in different processes, lawmaking, and what kind of impact it has on sex workers' rights. So, as a conclusive thought, it's not enough to have a declaration on paper. It has to be a living document, and it has to be made alive by all of you, by us, by the presidency. It's really important that the formation of strategic partnership continues. We all know that there are financial and other constraints that WAS is facing. WAS doesn't need to do everything alone. However, it has an incredible, important, unique voice in this work, like nobody else, no other organization in the world that can engage with WHO and those political player Gates Foundation, who give all the money for family planning, for example, without proper recognition of sexual rights. Engage as a prominent actor with these organizations. Don't try to do it alone. The formation of the partnership is incredibly important. It's very important, the multidisciplinary application of sexual rights. Can you raise the hand of you who are human rights lawyers in this? Okay, two, three, me. There are much more sexual health experts in a human rights conference than here human rights experts. We have to work on it. Human rights lawyers need to understand, lawyers, judges, prosecutors need to understand, those who work in forensic medicine need to understand the nitty-gritties of sexuality, bodily integrity, and sexual health. You are in the best position to bring together these different actors. And it's a time to develop standards of care. There is no international standard on reparation therapy. It could be WAS, based on the Sexual Rights Declaration, who works together with the World Association of Psychiatry, Psychology, WHO, UNAIDS, to finally issue a statement on these torturers and human rights and the act that violates human rights. So the eyes on you, and my deepest congratulations again for your declaration. Thank you so much.